Hey, what's going down, everybody? This your boy, Jay Mays, inside the Time Machine on WUAG 103.FM. Playing the best in new and old school hip-hop, R&B, and everything else in between. With me on the phone right now, I have Lionel Martin, accomplished music director and part of the pioneering music video show, Video Music Box, for those of you that may know it from the Tri-State area. Mr. Martin, welcome to the Time Machine.
Hey, thanks. Quick way to be here, man.
I appreciate you doing this interview, man. All right, now go ahead and tell the people, how did you get your start in hip-hop?
Wow. Well, I think I've just been very blessed, very lucky. I think I came along at the right time. Along with my partner, Ralph McDaniels, we both grew up in New York, and we started as DJs. You know, we used to spin at house parties, and then that eventually led to clubs. And when we were DJs, people like Russell Simmons with Rush Management would actually come to the different clubs we were working at and give us records, like, you know, Curtis Blow, and eventually Run DMC. But the early stuff that Rush had was stuff that we were given to play. And then Ralph, my partner, kind of was working at a station called WNYC, Channel 31 in New York, which was like a public access station at the time. And he had come up with an idea to do a show that would play like music videos and basically the hip-hop stuff. And the reason that he chose hip-hop is because back then there weren't that many things. I mean, MTV was around, but there wasn't many outlets for hip-hop music. And back then also, the hip-hop videos were really low budget, and they basically looked like crap. You know, they didn't look good because the record companies at that time were so small and independent. You know, they didn't put a lot of money into the hip-hop videos as opposed to their counterparts of the rock and the pop stuff. So Ralph had this idea to play these hip-hop videos and put the show together called Video Music Box. And since we had been partners as childhood friends and, you know, did the DJ stuff, he kind of called me one day and told me, like, you know, to check out the show and what he was doing and stuff. And I kind of came up with an idea because I thought it was pretty cool. I said, well, why don't we go to the various hip-hop artists at that time and let's get them on camera. Let's do interviews with them. Let's go to the clubs where they were performing at and stuff. And we basically changed the whole concept of the show from a show that just played music videos to a show that's pretty much the pioneer of what all these music video shows are today, you know. And that's basically how Video Music Box got started.
Yeah, definitely. That was a mouthful because I know being from down south, we didn't really know too much about it because we're not from the Tri-State area. For those of you that don't know, Tri-State area is New York, New Jersey, and Connecticut.
That's correct.
So it was like a big thing of the, like, wherever, like 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, everything was shut down. As soon as you hear that Houdini 5 minutes of funk, Video Music Box, Uncle Ralph with Lionel the Vid Kid.
Yeah, absolutely.
It was a wrap.
It was a wrap. People would run home from school to catch that show because it was the only source. It was the only place they could actually see hip-hop artists, you know, in their videos. And no matter how tacky the videos might have been back then, it was, if you're hungry for hip-hop and that's all you got, then you're going to eat it and you're going to enjoy it.
Right. And this was around the time when, okay, Music Box was going strong. Then you had Mr. Magic over at BLS.
That's correct. Mr. Magic was at BLS and at Hot 92 or... I think it was KRS at the time, was Red Alert.
Okay.
Yeah.
Another legendary hip-hop DJ pioneer who I also had the pleasure of interviewing a while back.
Right, absolutely.
You know, that was definitely worthwhile. Now, explain to me, by you being around when hip-hop first came about, we all know it from, you know, various documentaries and various books. What was it like growing up firsthand when this subculture was starting to rise?
It was surreal. That's the best way I can explain it to you because, you know, the music that was on the radio or this whole little hip-hop thing, I was just growing up in it. So I was, like, enjoying the music and loving it. I was part of something. I wasn't, like, an outsider looking in. I was, like, growing up in it and hearing the different stuff that was coming out. So it was kind of exciting to me. When I got an opportunity to eventually direct stuff, like my first video that I ever directed was Roxanne Shanté. It was called Roxanne's Revenge. Well, the way that came about is, you know, a young lady who I knew who was an editor and had cut a lot of hip-hop videos at the time, you know, we talked. I was working at Sesame Street, and she was telling me that she actually was editing. You know, we just talked. You know, she was a white girl too, so it was kind of interesting. And she was telling me about Divine Sounds and all these hip hop videos that she cut and put together. And I was like, kind of a little impressed. I was like, wow, that's kind of cool. Now, mind you, at this point, I hadn't even done anything hip hop or directed anything hip hop. And she told me that that it was a pretty interesting thing to get into, and she said she could hook me up. She said, I could probably get you to direct a video. And I said, well, I'd never done one before. And she said, well, you know, you seem like a smart guy. And we were both working in television film type of stuff as PAs. You know, we weren't doing anything big, but I did have a little bit of a knowledge. And she told me, well, there's this artist named Roxanne Shante, and her manager is this guy named Tyrone Williams, and I think I can get you this video. And I didn't even know who Roxanne Shante was, but I knew who Marley Marl was because I'd heard him on the radio, and he was actually the producer of the track. So we went into a little somebody's basement, might have been Marley's basement. We shot this video, which I'm not proud of to this day, because, you know, it was my first, but we shot it on 3/4 tape, which is like, you know, the lowest form of video back then. And it was kind of successful. It was kind of successful for Tyrone and stuff, and that was my first touch of it. But the point that I'm trying to tell you is I didn't know who these people were, and it was just kind of an interesting thing. And as this hip hop started to grow, I was noticing that a lot of the acts that I was doing would become major. The next person I did was C. Tyrone liked me, who had a company called Cold Chillin' Records, and he said, you know what, I got another act, and his name is MC Shan. And I was like, okay. So we did a video for him. And one thing that was cool about Tyrone, he liked what I was doing. The MC Shan video did so well that they got a deal with Warner Brothers. And Tyrone, being a cool, straight-up type of person that he was like, you know what, you're going to do all my acts. And that's how I got involved with Big Daddy Kane, Biz Markie, and, you know, the rest is kind of history, you know.
Right, because looking at that Roxanne's Revenge video, it looked like, shot in somebody's living room about 5-10 minutes and everything like that. And then, of course, you knew Marley because he produced that track, and then he also did the bridge with NC Shan, which led to the whole beef between the Juice Crew and BDP.
That's correct. That's correct.
Yeah, of course, I got.
We were living in dangerous times, too, because, you know, I was rolling with them doing videos, but I wasn't part of the little politics, the little disses that was going on between them. So at times, you know, doing the videos back then, our lives were a little bit in danger, but that was all part of the fun, you know, of being part of this new thing called hip-hop.
Right, so you had to protect your net at all times.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Right, now tell me a little bit about these guys. I feel, in my opinion, one of the most underrated singing groups, and they could rap too of that period, Foursome D's.
Oh yeah, Foursome D's were real cool. They were really cool, and they were different because they could rap, like you said, and they had a good harmony and stuff like that. And we actually got involved with them, Foursome D's, and Kid, what was his name, Kango, and it just opened up a whole other door for us, you know, because there were so many little companies starting up, you know, and it was kind of cool. I was getting a reputation as a pretty cool cat who would do the hip-hop videos, and the thing is, what I brought to the table, there weren't that many directors doing it at the time, but I come from like a film background, so I always wanted to make the videos as big as possible, and I always had beef that the hip-hop videos were done so crappy anyway. So I was looking at the big rock and roll videos, and basically the artists, when they would come to me, was like, I want some big shit. I want some TV stuff. I want some film stuff. I want my stuff to look really large and stuff. And that's how we started. I started to say, well, why not? Let's do it. And we started to come up with these little storylines and these whole movie concepts and everything. And back then, some of them, I would say, didn't look as great. But at least we were attempting to make them big. And, like, again, it was the pioneer. It was the groundwork for how you see videos today.